time to introduce Vern. So I've known Vern for many years. I'm certainly longer than he's known me. So, you know, my first encounter with him, with Vern, was when I started on my first research grant and project, which was doing log anonymization. And I quickly ran into this guy, this Vern guy. He's like, he's done all this work here. And so I always was trying to distinguish my work from Vern's work. And then I started getting more interested in network security monitoring. This Vern guy pops up again. I should probably just pay more attention to what Vern's doing now so I know what I'll be doing in the future, but... for those of you who don't know Vern, which I think is probably few of you, he's the father of Bro. He wrote it back when he was at Lawrence Berkeley Lab in 1995. He's a researcher focused on internet measurement of network activity and internet attacks. He is an electrical engineering and computer science professor at Berkeley and leads the network and security group at ICSI, the International Computer Science Institute. He still has a foot in LBL, I think, right? Yeah, I have no idea how he does all these. It should also not surprise you that Vern is well honored, and this is where our careers really differ. Vern is an ACM fellow, a SIGCOM, ACM SIGCOM awardee, an ACM Grace Murray Hopper awardee. ACM really likes you, I think. and my notes say you're also a 2015 IEEE Internet awardee, so. IEEE has love for you too. So I'd like to give a warm welcome to Vern.
All right, good morning. It's pretty awesome to be here and have an opportunity to engage with the Bro community that amazingly began 20 years ago. So what I want to do in this talk is sketch that trajectory. What did it take to go from ideas to where we are today? And I'm going to do it in two parts, one on technical issues and one on building the project. And I'm not quite sure about the timing here, so I may have to go quickly over a few parts. I'll try to keep that coherent. So let me begin with the origins and technical evolution. Today, you know, we have a polished, coherent, documented, and quite open and flexible framework. The real documentation of what happened in the design process and conceptualizing it comes mainly from the original Bro paper. I'm just curious, by the way, how many of you have read it? I don't mind either way, but okay, maybe a third. So in that paper, and I'm going to use that paper structure to drive some of the technical discussions, because that was really the conceptualization of what we're trying to do with Bro. It starts off saying, you know, before writing this system, we had operational experience of a simpler system based on offline analysis of TCP dump stuff. And I want to sketch where this came from, because it actually pretty profoundly shaped Bro. At the time, I was a PhD student at UC Berkeley working on network measurement. And an employee at Lawrence Berkeley National Lab. And in fact, I've been at the lab a long, long time. And the lab was the only reason I was able to do this PhD, because they had a continuing education program that would basically pay you to do your PhD. Wouldn't have happened otherwise. And I had just started in the early 90s with my first published research. This is one of the papers, Growth Trends and Wide Area TCP Connections. So even back then in the 90s, it was quite exciting to watch the internet grow. And among the various growth patterns, and I have some cool ones I can show you offline if you'd like to see them, were these plots, a little hard to read, of how many connections per day did Lawrence Berkeley Lab make. And I had 7 data sets, or 8, I'm not sure how many, 8 in here, which I had gathered by running TCP dump on the lab's border, which at that time was a smoking 10 megabit Ethernet that got upgraded to FDDI in the process. And I would compute based on the SYN and FIN packets, you know, how many connections we saw, and then plot for different protocols how many there were. And I'm sorry about this scaling. This is from the original paper. I don't have the data today to redo it. So the key here is it's log scaled on the y-axis. It's linear on the x-axis. So lines are exponential growth. So from this data, I was looking at most of the popular protocols grew 50 to 70% every year. And I have lovely data showing that that was not a transient, but I'm not going to go into it. That more than a decade of that sort of growth existed. Part of what was intriguing here was some of the growth was fueled by abuse, which really started on the radar of the lab in, I'd say, 93-ish time frame. There was also some amazing growth. You notice I didn't have HTTP on here. Well, let me add it. And so nothing up through 1992, and then it just exploded. In fact, if you fit that growth, that's 300 times a year, sustained over 2 years, and it was not tipping down at the end. So this was the sort of stuff I'd do. And the lab was facilitating all this research, but in the process, some of the operations guys would come to me and say, you know, we have this incident, and we would like to know, did you happen to capture it in your TCP dumps? And it started running TCP dump routinely, so I'd have these logs, and I'd go root through them looking for forensic information related to the analysis. And that then turned into scripts that would do this nightly. I want to pause here for a minute and just sketch what a rare opportunity it was being at Lawrence Berkeley Lab, and still is. And in fact, the whole origins of Bro and its growth are really a huge success story in my mind for Lawrence Berkeley National Lab. Just totally enabled it. So let me sketch a bit of that. First, I started at the lab as a high school student, believe it or not, and I was taught programming by, and software engineering in particular, by a number of guys, one of whom was Steve Miller, who went on to write, you know, one of the books on software engineering. So that was terrific. And then I joined the networking group, which was led by Van Jacobson, who's the guy who designed TCP's congestion control and pretty much made the internet viable. And that was in the late 80s. And in the process, wrote TCP dump and PCAP. So all those core tools, that was the guy that was supervising my work at the lab. And just a terrific opportunity to learn from these people. OK, so let me now go to thinking about the design of this system. So I've been in this milieu where I'm running these scripts, and every night we crunch on them and spit out reports. And it's starting to feel like, wow, it would be great to do this, A, in real time, not wait till the next day to tend to things, B, with a lot more analysis, flexibility, and power. And so I sat down to design the system. And this was, unlike some systems, you know, grow sort of ad hoc as you go, you know, that's just the reality of it. This one, though, I had the benefit of being able to just sit down and design it. Think about, okay, I want a system that's going to achieve the following properties. So this is all in early 1995. And in the paper, the paper calls out these properties. I'm going to work my way through these, talking about the system and its original design and how it evolved. So let me first go through the system's architecture, which is the structure that was the way to meet these goals. And the way I always frame this is, well, we start off with a source of information that we want to analyze. And in general, for Bro, this is the network. So we're tapping the network using passive taps. Up comes an entire copy of whatever's on the wire. We feed that into libpcap to filter it down, right? So part of the worry here in the design has always been, how do you go sufficiently fast? Well, you got to throw away a bunch of work because you just don't have enough processing to do all of it. And we'll come back to that point in a bit. So in the system, it gets through the libpcap, and there's some TCP dump filter, which is controlled separately. It's not no presumption about what the filter is. That's going to winnow down the stream. That then goes into the event engine, which is consuming this stream and abstracting it into descriptions, higher level descriptions of activity. And one key thing here is that the events are policy neutral. There's no assumption at this level in the architecture of good or bad. That's really vital. And if you look at some other systems architecture, they do make that assumption at this point. So for example, in Snort, in its original architecture, it was not really a crisp line between I found a thing and the thing is bad. The two got bundled, which had some advantages and some big disadvantages. So the event engine is consuming this stream. Now, it's only doing work based on which events have been deemed of interest, and that's external to it. So this is another way to shed load. One way we shed load is we set the filter. Another is we say which events we care about. And it's not going to do the work for events we don't care about. Okay. And then that stream goes into an interpreter of a domain-specific language, which also gets called Bro, so the Bro scripting language. And there is where one codifies, well, what do I think about those events? And you could think all sorts of things about them. You can think about them in security context, which was the main design, but you can think about them in a pure network analysis context. I just want to know what's going on in my network. I want to know which URLs are popular, which things fail, you know, et cetera. Whatever you want to code. And the power here is, well, we can have a lot of state from what happened in the past. So we can build up complicated relationships across activity. Very different than, say, a pure signature model. We can input additional sources of information. I'll talk about that in a little bit, and our own policies. But in particular, we can react. We can take action. And some of this is write it out to disk, log it, and we'll come back to that in a minute. Another, hey, real-time alert. And finally, don't just alert, run a program. And now you respond in real time. So that's how the architecture tries to achieve those goals. Now, before going on through the how the technology developed, let me ground you in, okay, what does the architecture look like today? So you don't have this picture, which is not the final story. But before doing that, let me comment. We're here 20 years after this design because the architecture was right, you know, I don't want to be immodest about that, but I do totally want to credit the years of learning about software engineering that I got at LBL. But that's what it takes for a system to not only survive but successfully evolve without becoming a huge mess. The architecture has to be right. That said, the architecture has changed somewhat, and as follows. So here's the original. And first, we've got a big change down at the very bottom, which is we're no longer running one bro on the network stream. We're running a bunch of bros. And this is vital for scaling. This comes about due to bros clusterer. The nice thing about making that change there is it doesn't really affect much above it. The second change is we no longer bet on being able to filter down the stream. Back in the 90s, you could successfully filter the stream quite well just based on well-known ports. and TCP flags. As abuse of the network evolved over the following decade, lots of interesting traffic moved off port. And so if one's presumption was just by looking at the port, you could find the traffic of interest, you'd miss it. This led to our development of dynamic protocol detection. So let me back up a moment. So there's a number of hacks to deal with traffic moving off port, such as, okay, let's run a regular expression at the beginning of the stream and guess what it is. What I like about DPD is it's more fundamental, it's more principled, and technically how it works is as a stream comes in for some connection, it figures out what possible protocols could it be that Bro knows about, and it just tries them all until their parsers give up and say, I can't parse that. And the parser that can parse it has identified it, and that's very robust and remarkably efficient because generally the parsers make that decision very, very soon in the stream. All right, so now we've lost this filtering ability because we need that visibility. And that's going to push us on performance, but we gained the clustering ability. This part of the architecture hasn't really changed the event engine other than the notion of now we're getting events from sources other than just the network, which always fit in the general model because events don't presume they're about a network. They're just about, at some point in time, a thing happened. And I've got a bunch of information associated with it. So now we can get events based on reading from sockets or other bros communicating with us. And at this level, again, the architecture hasn't changed, so it's really grown and blossomed there, and which I'll talk about in a bit in terms of lots of added functionality and, in particular, frameworks for doing types of analysis. So let's see. We're about 15 minutes into this. I'm wondering if there are comments or questions on this before I go ahead. I'm going to start talking about the design goals. I'm hard of hearing, so I can't hear. Oh, yeah. Well, I don't know if anyone has a question. It's the professor in me. I got to do it. All right. Let's keep going. Design goal: high speed, large volume monitoring. And here, the paper frames, well, what's our number one threat is at the lab, and I'm glad, you know, that I was able at that time to say, look, this is not the security monitor for everything. This is for a certain type of threat model. Threat model, mainly external threat. You're going to monitor your border is fast. And at the time, key enabler for all of this was a donation of what were then the hot hardware, DEC alphas. So Jeff Mogul, who's a researcher, I think he's now at Google, but he was at DEC at the time, facilitated this donation in 1995 of $24,000 worth of hardware that could go fast enough to do that FDDI, 100 megabit. By the way, I mentioned money in the talk a fair amount, because I do want to convey what does it cost to build such a system, build a community, and so forth. It's not cheap, and so I want to frame that. Another design goal was, hey, we better not drop any packets. No packet filter drops. Now, this is the measurement guy in me, which is that for measurement, you know, those drops are a pain. Boy. Means you don't really have a faithful reproduction of what's going on. But in particular, then there's the worry that you will miss the thing of interest. If you're dropping, you know, you can't see it, you can't process it. And a corollary, a worry in the back of one's mind that the attacker will induce packet loss. Now, this in its pure form has actually turned out not to be the case, right? We've run in many environments where there is packet loss. You don't like it, but you know, you still get a great deal of utility out of the system. And part of what I think sometimes doesn't go fully appreciated is it's not black and white, right? There's this whole spectrum of utility you get out of a system depending on how much it can provide you. And this problem, unless your packet loss is high, is not the end of the world, even though it's quite unsettling. One thing I really liked, though, was that we developed a bro script that could tell you what is your packet loss. And it could tell you regardless. Because if you read the counters the kernel gives you, or God forbid what libpcap tells you, they lie. They're wrong. They tell you you have loss when you don't. They tell you you don't have loss when you do. I have instances measuring both of these. So you can't trust them. What's nice about this script is it just looks at the consistency of TCP activity and says, it really ought to be the case that anytime I see an acknowledgement, I saw the data. And if I didn't, it was lost, assuming we have a single vantage point. There's no multipathing. So this script, you just drop it in there, and now you know what your loss rate is. And you want to see it like 1 in 10,000, something like that. You don't take my earlier comments to mean, you know, 5% is okay. It's not. But a few is not the end of the world. All right, now let me take these two collectively together and talk about going fast, because that is the tension here. We want to do high volume monitoring, and we don't want loss. And I'm going to sketch this in a series of papers. This is how I'm going to structure it. Papers is what we do at ICSI and UC Berkeley. I mean, that's the ultimate output of research. It's the papers, not the software system, for example. So I'm going to sketch this in terms of papers. Every time I have something in, you know, this is just cut and pasted from the title in one of these with a date, is to give you a sense. There was a paper talking about this thing at that time. So this paper marks collaborating with Anya Feldman, who's now at TU Berlin, and her group, which included a bunch of very talented students who wound up and often coming to Berkeley, Robin being one of them. And in this work, we're looking at how do you make this system actually operationally viable? And the problem is sketched here. So MWN is this large network in Munich, university network. And the paper's saying, you know, if we run on this input, so this is how many connections every minute there are, 40 to 80,000. This is back in 2004. Then we profile the memory use, it just goes up and up and up, and then we crash. Not very good. And the fix for this was to introduce the notion of timing out state, which Bro does in a very fine-grained way. You can just control per state you're tracking, how long should it live, and what things should refresh it and keep it alive. And with that change, then memory grows quite slowly. It's still growing here, and ultimately got it to where it won't grow at all. And that means you can run the thing however long you want, and it's not going to crash. Another thing in that same work, this is something that isn't used today so much. The first really is. And I want to frame some of those things. What have we left by the wayside, or what is still waiting to be developed or explored? Load levels is a notion of tracking the CPU load on the system and changing the amount, the sort of fundamental processing it does by changing like the TCP dump filter or the scripts that are active to dynamically shed load as we get burdened. So here we see as the load levels are crossing various thresholds as spikes in the CPU come, and then we get rid of the spike. We're able to offload the CPU by shedding some of our monitoring. Now, at this time, this is the mid-2000s, there's just a ton of research came out on how do you make intrusion detection fast. And it was all so focused on I can build an FPGA that can match a signature really good, or an ASIC, or, you know, I've got my data structure. It was all about, I want to find this byte string in a packet. which is not very useful. For one, it may not be in one packet, it may be in several, so you really need to be reassembling streams. But more broadly, you don't care about that particular signature unless you know the context. You need to parse what's going on. And these papers wouldn't do that because they would come from the world of hardware designers who didn't appreciate that this problem really is much deeper than just find this pattern in a given chunk of data. So in 2006, we put together our overall vision of how do we design to go really fast but deep. And I'm not going to go through this vision because this is not really what not all that germane to what we're going to talk about, other than the last part of it here, which is that up through here, it's really easy to parallelize. So this is saying, you know, once you got a packet, figure out its flow and then parallelize it based on the flow and analyze the flow, the connection, whatever, and it's embarrassingly parallel. Great. But once you get into wanting to do aggregate policies, how do these flows interrelate? Or global policies, what is going on in my network across a bunch of hosts? Now it gets really hard to parallelize. Right? So you've spread out all that information across whatever, however you're parallelizing. Now you've got to bring it back together. So this is a problem that half of it is easy and half of it is quite hard. Pushing on it, the Bro cluster addresses both, you know, how do you fan out your traffic across a whole bunch of nodes, and then thinking about you've got these policy scripts that are written to analyze across connections, how do we make those work? And the bottom line is some of them you can figure out how to parallelize, some are quite hard. Some of them are now not in Bro because they don't parallelize well. This is just plotting, okay, what is the performance of Bro cluster across all these nodes? And you can see that it keeps the CPU utilization really quite low. We have one straggler there. And here how it scales from 3 to 5 to 10 nodes. So we indeed achieve essentially linear scale up with nodes. And that's great. That's what you need to go really fast. In this time frame, we are also pursuing a architecture called shunting. Now, this came out of LBL's operators back in 2002, actually. I traced it all the way back to Steve Lau, at least, in 2002, had this architecture in mind. And what shunting does is it's an inline hardware element. As packets arrive, you look them up in a bunch of tables in parallel. And you get a decision. A decision can be drop it, forward it, or divert it. And if it's not in the table, you divert it. This thing, now that's a high-speed hardware inline element. This thing is just a software element that's going to make some decision. What do I think about this packet? And what that usually means is, what do I think about this flow? The key being, you can decide, this is a big flow. I don't want to look at it anymore, so I can shed load. In which case, you download into here a forward, saying, when you see that connection in the future, just forward it. Or the element could decide, that's enough, you're an attacker, and now drop. Or it could decide, you know, I got to keep seeing you, keep shunting. Now, what I think is this was the architecture that was being used for supercomputing back in 2002 to make things scale. What's really remarkable to me looking at this is that Steve had invented OpenFlow. That's what that is. It's exactly OpenFlow in its essence. And here, though, because of the focus stayed on security, it didn't get broadened into the richer thing OpenFlow became. Moving along with architecture, this is our sort of overall architecture for going fast. And I have it here because for you to think about, all right, where would Bro be going to go faster still? And we know we got to go faster and faster. Now, in this architecture, we have an inline element. This is essentially like shunting. It's a shunting element. It's got tables. It's going to look up incoming packets in and then dispatch them. Now, dispatch means send them, well, it could forward them, send them to various cores that are running bro processing on them. And I'm not going to go through this in gory detail, but I want to highlight two things. One is you don't forward the packet as well as send a copy, like bro, it works passively, but you hold on to the packet. And in fact, the packet might even be altered. So this architecture allows you to change the traffic going through it. The other thing I will point out is external messages. So the architecture has fundamentally in mind that you are communicating with other such parallel processing units elsewhere in your network. I'm almost done with hardware stuff, high-performance stuff. This paper appeared last year, Hilty. I have down here, 2009 is when we first tried to publish this idea. It took quite a while. It was not really appreciated by the target audience in the research world. The idea of Hilty is devise a abstract instruction set for doing network processing. So it's got a whole bunch of groups of instructions, just like, you know, like a Java VM has abstract instructions. And the idea then is you've got some application analysis that you want to do. You have a compiler that's going to target Hilty. So you don't write in Hilty. It's a low-level beast. Only Robin does that. But you have a compiler that's going to spit out Hilty code. Hilty, in turn, is compiled into LLVM bytecode. So LLVM, this is mature compiler technology, knows how to generate parallelizable code for all sorts of architectures. So the tool chain is you specify a high-level thing. That's compiled to Hilty. Hilty, in turn, compiles to LLVM. LLVM compiles to your actual iron. The goal here is to do two things. One is, first, provide a whole bunch of building blocks for common network analysis tasks. Just write them once, rather than everyone writing them over and over and over. And second, compile them to something that knows how to go parallel. This is half of the roadmap. I'll talk about the other half at the very end, of going towards compiled bro scripts for much higher performance. A long line, I'm not going to go through this. I'm just going to have it up there for you to decide whether you want to go check out that paper, also work that Robin and colleagues have been doing on what is the right concurrency model for rich network monitoring and intrusion prevention. And this is a technically crucial problem because, as I mentioned earlier, it's not as simple as just split it up across the flows and you're done. If you want to do rich analysis, you have to somehow coordinate those flows and all their access to state. So I'm not going to have time to go into this, but I'll leave it there for you to mull over. And I also want to frame this probably is on your radar, hopefully is some stats, is the framework that Seth and I'm going to not get everybody right, so I'll just Seth et al. Have worked on to do computation on across all these parallel entities of summary statistics. I want to know what are the large or small values, the mean values, and so how do you compute aggregate information in parallel? Obviously, you can just gather all the information and do it sequentially. It's not going to be fast enough. Last thing I want to frame here is this talk at Bro for Pros by Ashish and Vince on going 100 gig. So the I think that the bottom line is that the architecture has been able, with a bunch of additions, to scale up to today's networking speeds, and I would expect it to continue to do that. It takes a whole lot of work. Right? We're adding a lot of additional design to do that, but we're able to do it. All right, so that's my discussion of high performance. Let me go to real-time notification. This was another core part of the design goals of the system was, look, you got to be able to do stuff in real time. And indeed, if you go back to the hardware donation from DEC, one piece of it was this $3,000 dual-attach FDDI card. And it's dual-attach so that at that time already, in 95, we're thinking about we want a reactive firewall. We want something that will be able to immediately block traffic. We didn't actually do that inline for at the time because we couldn't go fast enough. However, you can get almost as good, even back then, by communicating between Bro, watching things, and your firewall or border router, whatever thing that Bro can tell it, hey, install an ACL and block something. So to illustrate this in how this evolved, I have some data here on one of the benefits of Bro's extensive logging and being a pack rat is, you know, you can go back in time and look at data. How did the world actually evolve? Because you've got rich information about it. So what I'm plotting here is from a study we did of scanning. How many hosts every day scanned LBL? Log scale, 1, 100, 10,000. And so we're just mining LBL's archive of connections, plotting this out. And so things hum along. In the 90s, around, you know, I don't know what that is, 50 a day or so. And then they start to pick up. And they actually start to pick up right when LBL, 1989, decides to allow Bro to automatically block traffic, which was a really big deal. You know, the network operators are always very conservative, understandably, about things that tinker with traffic and can mess it up. But by 99, the operators at LBL had enough confidence in Bro's scan detection, which was written to be conservative, to allow it to automatically connect to the border router and block traffic. Here we see the rise of sort of automated tools. And then what I like about this plot is the entire world literally changes overnight in 2001. And it never comes back. One day, everything changes. Well, what the hell happened there? Worms. So Code Red 1 is released, and suddenly the internet is chock full of scanners. And now scan blocking becomes really quite important, because until we got into a regime of, you know, discipline about patching and tightening up connectivity, all that scanning out there meant a vulnerable thing would be found. It would just would be found. Boom. Let me digress a little on this plot because I find it quite interesting. This is not worms. This is what I would call auto routers, botnets that would scan and compromise but don't self-propagate. They got very, very aggressive, peaking in around 2004. And then it starts to fall off, though it never goes back like it was, to right around coincident. I don't know if these are linked or not, to when cybercrime picks up. And by the way, this is what I spend a good amount of my time. You want to know what you're doing in the future, cybercrime, stuff like that. Finally, just because it's eye candy, I can't resist. This is from a study we did of, okay, what services are scanned over time? And this is all mined out of prologs. The circles scale with the volume of scanning. And it's not a linear scaling, okay? So it's it's you can't directly read, but you can see various seismic events. Like that is code red launching. Not nearly as big as those auto routers and some of the SMB worms later. One thing I like about this plot is it shows, hey, way back in the early 90s, constant scanning for SMTP. Those spammers, you know, that's what they're going after. And these are most likely crawlers, not malicious HTTP scanning. Here's a favorite of mine, scanning for the backdoor left by other malware. Slowly gets cleaned up. All right. So the other part of, if you read this rationale in the original paper, it says, real time's great. There is enormous utility in keeping extensive permanent logs. And I would bet that far and away, that is the value people most extract typically from Bro. You know, the real-time stuff, if you've got a problem you can fit it into, if you're able, if you're set up to do blocking, great. But no matter what, those logs are invaluable. So I'm going to only mention a bit about the logs here, one bit, just for reasons of time, which is a complementary view. Oh, by the way, so Matthias will be talking about VAST later in BroCon, and that is the real vision for where logging is going. The time machine is a way of thinking about bulk recording of traffic, and its core argument is made in this plot. So this is traffic from NERSC Supercomputer Center, LBL, and Munich network, and it's saying, how big are connections? And the plot here is a complementary CDF. So, you know, this line here, only 10% of all connections are to the right of it, below it. This is log scaled. And so what it's saying is that almost all of your traffic, 90% of it, is small. It's 20 kilobytes or less. Back when this was done, that figure will move a little, not much by now. And so, if you record only 20 kilobytes max per flow, you can still record all the flows. 90% of them, you have the entire flow. 10% of them, you got the beginning, which is the juicy part very much. You can hugely offload how many bytes you have to actually process. And using this, you can now do bulk recording of packets at scale. So I checked. One site has about 70 terabytes that they use just for Time Machine. And when you've got that much, you can keep months and months of more or less all packets. Now, it's not all because it's not the tails of the big connections. But for forensic analysis, forensic purposes, it's just about everything. All right, let me talk now about design goals. Mechanisms should be separate from policy. That is the event engine being sharply different from the policy script interpreter. That is, mechanism is events, this notion of asynchronous activity. And extensibility, which is closely related to separating mechanism from policy. What allows you to extend a system? The fact that its structure, its mechanisms, don't presume what you want to do with it. So I'm going to just touch on some of the ways the system has been extended. The this work from 2012 is on the input framework, which many of you may use in your operational bros. And here, it's a general framework for, you've got external data sources that may be updated in real time that you want to incorporate into Bro. So this is a type of extensibility that is possible because Bro's assumption that an event is not necessarily a network event, it's just an asynchronous piece of information. Another form of extensibility has been work that Robin and colleagues have done on analyzing industrial control protocols. A domain went really, totally not on my radar designing the system. And in fact, the whole bunch of things, more than 100 papers you can see from bro.org. And I put up here ones that are mainly not security, just to underscore that the utility of the system, its extensibility, its application to other domains, is really quite broad. Another design goal, don't screw up. Well, don't screw up stupidly. And the basic idea here was, you know, if you can prevent a class of errors, do it. Right? And the most powerful way to do that is a language that makes it hard to make errors. So the Bro scripting language attempts to be such a language. Now, it's a pastiche of a number of influences in my computing life at that time. S is now more familiar to folks as R, which is the freeware version of S. Lovely statistical analysis framework, and really influenced a lot of the thinking about dealing with aggregates that went into the Bro design. Now I'm talking about the Bro scripting language. Awk, I'm an awk hacker, okay? Never converted to Perl. Can't believe Python doesn't do strong typing. Just amazed, what a botch. But so awk, just sort of, which also doesn't do strong typing because it has no types, really. Awk, I liked how one can easily express various things in it, and that was part of the influence. C++, both writing the system and some of the notions, some of the syntax and the like. But the one that might surprise you is ML, which you might not know at all, is a, in pure terms, though ML is richer than this, a functional language. And it was part of my graduate education in my languages course. The language we really studied was ML. And what is ML's influence on Bro is on its type system. The thing that amazed me when I was doing ML programming, when that thing compiled, it worked. The type system was so strong that if you could get something through the type system, it worked. That was just great. And so this is why Bro is strongly typed. It's also why Bro is implicitly typed. You know, I noticed some people in their examples, you know, code up, hey, I've got a local foo colon int equal 5 and so forth. I mean, I didn't want to bother with the types. I find it, they get in the way. I just say whatever the type is, the initializer's type. That's the type, obviously. So that notion of rich inferred types comes from ML. And the deeper influence came from when I did software for the superconducting supercollider, which was designed at by a team at Lawrence Berkeley Lab, though they were logistically separate from the lab. And that software led to this paper I published in 93 on a system called GLISH. The key thing for our purposes, GLISH was an event-based system. So going into Bro, I had already done an event-based system and knew how powerful it was. And I didn't invent events for this. They came out of accelerated control software at CERN. The language evolved in a number of ways over time. I'm not going to go through these because I'm short of time. Though I will do a shout out to ESNet in general and Greg in particular. 2002, we started working on IPv6. I have email from Greg saying, hey, it would be good, you know, we're actually doing some IPv6 traffic, and we don't want to do it unless we can monitor it. But a whole bunch of development. The particularly satisfying thing here, and I had nothing to do with this, I should add, is the frameworks that got added with Bro 2.x. So these unified ways of dealing with classes of analyses, what a great extension to the original language. And it's all done inside the original language with some modifications, but brings a lot of power. The last design goal was more like a reminder. The monitor will be attacked. And I have this part of my mind that's really paranoid. And it helps a great deal working on security. And writing the code, I kept thinking, every time you write an if, it's like, well, what if that's not true? What am I assuming here? How can the monitor be manipulated? So part of the design was to try to account for that. This is why Bro has a weird framework. It's often, I'm assuming people know, I mean literally weird. I mean, this is what Bro calls things it looks at that are not really events. They're sort of lower level things that it says something weird happened and it generates text about it. That framework comes out of worrying about all these corner cases. So in the code, when you get to something, well, surely X is the case. Well, if it's not, that's a weird. I don't have time to go into this. I'd love to chat with people that are interested. But this actually turned out to not be the right goal in some ways. Not a mistake, I would say, so much, but overemphasized. So this led to a whole bunch of research. And I have slides I've taken out on papers on evasion and so forth. But the bottom line is that evasive attacks are not, at this level, at layers 3 and 4 in particular, are not that prevalent. Evasion in layer 7 is hugely prevalent, but you can't do much about that. It's really hard. And so part of this, I think, that the reason these assumptions about layer 3 and 4 manipulation, which is mostly what this is talking about, haven't mattered is because attacks and I think this is an inevitable progression, inevitably move higher and higher semantic levels. So they start low-level attacks, and the low-level ones aren't so hard to deal with because semantically they're not that complicated. And then they move up into the app layer, and then they move up into things built on the app layer. So today's like social network attacks, what is it? It's just all a bunch of HTTPS. I mean, it's really hard to analyze from a network perspective. Okay, that's my tour of the design. Gonna go now, by the way, I think I'll finish right around 10:30 here, getting antsy, to how the project evolved. And I'm gonna illustrate this against various growth trends. Here I've plotted papers, that actually means just the original Bro paper. How many downloads were there for the Bro paper? Cumulative. And distros is how many downloads of Bro distributions, starting back when it was released. All right, so the timeline begins. I already told you about this, that packet traces that I gather are used for security. LBL wants to then operationalize this. By the way, the building Bro was always about, at the time, operations. It was not a research project for me. That was my other thesis stuff. It was cool that it turned out to be research. That was great. Shortly after this, or right around that time, we had an incident with a summer-long tracking of a guy who was using spoofing and NFS attacks that sort of turned into our big incident that we, the biggest probably at LBL since the Cuckoo's Egg incident. Now, if you're curious why I added that photo, talk to me over beers. So Bro's then sort of released publicly. You could email me and get a copy when the paper comes out. It's not wonderfully documented. I always love that little one-liner about documentation. We get a user manual 3 years later, and it's still weak. So the system, you know, it's got some people out there struggling to use it, not a whole lot. Now, Snort comes along in 1998. There's a paper in late 99. And then SourceFire comes around, commercial company, in 3 years. And for the longest time, you know, Snort's been the natural point of comparison for Bro. There you go, freeware thing, analyzes network traffic. And Snort just exploded. It was amazing. And baffling in some ways. And in retrospect, I think it is not so baffling because Snort's model is conceptually simple. You understand the idea of what it's trying to do, and you can share readily. So, you know, if I code up some Snort signature for thread X, I can give it to you, and it'll find thread X for you. So it found a really nice sweet spot, and the rise of automated attacks meant that those signatures were quite useful. It meant the attack I see, low-level attacks I see, the sort of, you know, indiscriminate attacks, you're going to see too. OK, then the next big event, Robin starts working on Bro as a student. Here he is working at the beach. And he comes and interns with us. And he never is really, you know, looking back after that point. We do tutorials. And now I'm going to switch scale. There's a announcement of Bro on public mailing lists, and that is a big change in action. Now, while these numbers are pretty big, 15,000 downloads of the paper and eventually the distros, it's nothing compared to Snort. And it's hard to know what those numbers mean. Being a measurement guy, let me back up for a sec. So what are 15,000 downloads? Is that 15,000 people who read the paper? Who run Bro? No, I mean, I'm sure it's much smaller, and some of them are going to be repeat visits, and some of them are going to be robots that have no intent of doing anything, and you know, but you can see the overall trend. So, late 2003, National Science Foundation, so I just sketched in the first part this terrific environment at Lawrence Berkeley Lab for doing this work, and utterly key enabler to it, and tying Bro to operations all along is just invaluable. And sometimes, as a researcher, I feel like, you know, I've got such an unfair advantage because there's this operating team that wants to work on me with my research. The dual of that for what I'm sketching now is the National Science Foundation. Right? So NSF, back in 2003, first started supporting Bro. And we went and pitched to NSF viable network defense for scientific research institutes. And we asked for, remember I told you I'm going to flag money here. We asked for $1.6 million. We got 900,000. Okay, nice chunk of change. And in that we had, hey, we're going to nucleate a Bro development community. But that was budgeted at about 10% of the overall effort, and it was not enough for us to do it at the time. Plus, I think at the time we didn't really have all the pieces. We do publish a whole bunch on this. So, you know, a lot of research comes out of this. The seeds of all that hardware work, a bunch of things on using Bro that I haven't had time to frame. And then moving forward, Department of Energy funds a thing we called Bro Lite. And this was, the notion was, so we added a signature engine to Bro specifically to try to steal Snort users. And that's why it came with a Snort to Bro, you know, script that would convert your favorite Snort sigs. And here, DOE was going to fund a project to take Bro and package it up. And in particular, the Lite part referred to emphasize the signatures. People understand those. Give them the signatures, and then once they're hooked on using the system, give them more functionality. That was the overall strategy. We won't really know how that went because the following year, almost exactly a year, the guy at DOE who was the head proponent of this, he was out, and someone else was in, and they killed the project. again, the subtext here is, you know, why did it take 20 years? So I'm giving you some of that. Now let me look at a broader version of this plot. Still, you can see an interesting inflection. Papers, you know, the interest at most, this is the original paper, you know, if you factored in the more recent ones, it would probably at least grow linear. But the distros really, really pick up. Late 2005, right around 2006, LBL is saying, look, it's not fast enough. We need a cluster. So due to operational requirements, not a research vision or anything, we work on the cluster. And this is Matthias's first big bro project. And what was cool about the cluster, once we had it, was no one else had it. You know, the other, you know, you couldn't buy your Snort cluster, even though that would have been really pretty easy to put together due to Snort's model. And so now Bro is interesting in terms of scaling. It's interesting to high-speed sites. And also leads then to Bro control. Once you got the cluster, it starts to get pretty clunky to control it. And so Robin, I believe, was the lead on putting together Bro control. From my point of view, this is an interesting point, though, an important point. This was hard to sell as research. You know, right around then, I was interviewing at Berkeley for the faculty position, and they did not want to hear about some cluster. I mean, you know, how hard can that be? Well, it turns out it's hard. But, you know, people, there's these research problems that people don't appreciate the difficulty. In fact, this was something Robin and I ran into quite often back in this time frame, is we would have a quite forward-looking research paper, and the reviewers wouldn't even understand why you needed this thing. All right. Then 2006, we start chatting with this Seth Hall guy at Ohio, and this is the this is an interesting experience, right? We've been talking with operators at LBL, and a bunch of them are, you know, into Bro and stuff. But you know, Seth is a force of nature, as you may know, and someone outside of our ecosystem in Berkeley. First, sort of, wow, we've got a power user really into it, teaching us stuff about it that we didn't know, essentially. We go to pitch a continuation of the Bro project to NSF. We say, hey, how about $2 million? They say, how about $230,000? So we're just squeaking by. And then we enter the like dark era, all right? SourceFire IPOs. Snort's just terrifically successful. Homeland Security goes with Suricata rather than Bro. This was frustrating. You know, I had Doug Mann at DHS, he knew about Bro, I'd talked with him and stuff. I was kind of struck that he decided to, you know, from the ground up, which was his the framing of Suricata, rather than go with Bro. However, so right then it's looking like, oh man, you know, time to do more research and forget about, you know, building. But NSF, the SDCI program comes on our radar, and we're thinking about, okay, this is a something we could pitch a large project to. And we find out that NCSA is also thinking about doing something along those lines for Blue Waters. So we partner, and we pitch. And we go with, you know, let's enhance Bro for operational network security monitoring in scientific environments. How about $3 million? They say, OK, here's $3 million. And this is gold, yeah, in a lot of ways. So in it, you know, there's a bunch of stuff we say we're going to do. And in particular, extensive up-to-date documentation and support, crucial. Yeah, one thing about Bro, it's just a big learning curve. There's no way around that if you want to use it richly. And I don't think there can be. I think, and I don't, let me back up and frame that differently. I don't think that's a flaw of the system or the architecture. Maybe the flaw of the fact that it's us researchers doing a lot of this, and we tend not to spend time on documentation because that's not what that's not research. But I think the system's power is fundamentally complicated. So extensive up-to-date documentation and support, and another, unify the code base. Now, you may not have seen the fruits of this, but or actually you have if you've used, for example, the frameworks. Right? The frameworks are part of the unifying of the code base. Also under the hood in C++ land. Another significant thing here, this is when Robin essentially becomes, not just essentially, does become the lead of the Bro project. Right? He's the lead PI on this. And the work I've described, I put up a bunch of stuff that's appeared since 2010 earlier. I'm not an author on most of that. Most of that is other people, Robin and colleagues. Now, when we do this pitch, we have two big pieces of luck. One is Seth is actually hireable. Great. So we hire him at ICSI. And the second is that the collaboration works. Now, I've been in a number of multi-institute collaborations. I have one long-standing one that has worked for a decade with San Diego. That's it. It's hard to make them work. And so this is really a tribute to Adam and, in general, to the team. I mean, I think that the fact that, you know, separated by 2,000 miles, the team works very effectively is striking. And it's an absolute key enabler. All right, let's go into more of the modern era. Now, I couldn't find data that matched the earlier curve. So I started over with downloads of distros. This is now from bro.org. And downloads of the original paper, just so we have that sense of growth. So the SDCI pitch to NSF, that was a three-year thing. And NSF was, Kevin Thompson in particular, very encouraging about, look, this is great stuff's happening. More time's going to be needed. So we pitch. We ask for $3.7 million, and we get $3.4 which is great. And this is the Bro Center for Expertise that Adam mentioned in his opening remarks. And it has a whole bunch of stuff in it. The one I want to frame right here is focal point of Bro's open source development. So the center is the nucleus for that. Here's another plot. Our Twitter presence. Yeah, I remember in 2011 or whenever, Robin's like, we should get on Twitter. I'm like, oh, you gotta be kidding. Yeah. Such an old school guy. So it's growing at 500 a year in followers. And then here, there's a big push to get the word of Bro out there and appear to induce a modal shift. And now we're growing at 1,100 per year. So I take that as one sign of the community's interest in the system. Another that I find interesting is, well, who's contributing to the system? And the way I compute this is I go through the change logs and I mine out all the names, sort of a pain, and then figure out who's credited in the change log when. So you can see here, that's why there's a bunch of spikes. Those are Bro releases, right? So I don't have a finer grained date. By the way, something I should add, I mean, you know, these are a year apart easily. This has been, I think, a key strength of the project is we are not trying to get stuff out there quickly that isn't really ready. We really value stuff that's solid and, you know, we care about quality. It matters to us. And so the releases are more deliberate, and we get, therefore, these spikes. Now, here we've shifted to how we maintain the change log. So the change log's being updated as changes are coming in, as opposed to only updated at the releases. This part I find really encouraging, right? So a whole lot of people recently are contributing, and the vector's going up. This, on the other hand, is growing quite slowly. This is who contributes quite a bit. And I think this grows slowly because it is a fundamentally complicated system. And if you're going to be contributing a lot, it still takes a lot of investment of your time into this system. All right, let me finish with a few thoughts on going forward. I'm going to frame, I think, what I think of, you know, a lot is in the pipeline and various, you know, features and capabilities and so forth. I'm going to frame what to me are the four of the most interesting. One of these is pushing towards deeper visibility. And this is a term, deep bro, that came out of LBL, meaning extensive. So LBL runs, I don't know how many, who can tell me, how many bros does LBL run? How many? 15 or so. Okay. So this is the vision here is you want to comprehensively monitor your interior networks. So, you know, that's a lot of deployment. and has a couple technical challenges, one of which is understanding all those enterprise protocols, which is amazing how understudied enterprise traffic is. Just if you go into the academic literature, you'll find our paper, which is a first look, and a few others, and that's it. Nothing is known about those protocols. So one has to develop analyzers for them. And then also, you want to coordinate this analysis. Performance. So I talked about Hilti, which was the language enabling this tool chain to LLVM. I talked about parallel architectures. SPICY is the successor to BINPACK. I don't know if you know BINPACK, but this is our domain-specific language for describing network protocols, and with SPICY, broader things like file formats, and automatically generating parsers for them. SPICY can then take these descriptions and compile them to Hilti. And in general, this is where we're going for fully multi-threaded, multi-core bro, which today it's not, right? You might think it is, and you can kind of get some of it from the cluster, but we want to fully leverage where computer architecture in general is going. Archive, vast, as I said before, Matthias will be talking about this. This is his dissertation work at Berkeley, and it is a very high-performance framework or system for logging events, where you know a target in ingestion rate, 100,000 per second up to maybe a million a second. And so archive means in a way that you can then analyze. And in particular, it's designed to facilitate forensic analysis. And also indicators of compromise, both capture them as you develop them and import them from others. Finally, the Bro Foundation, I think, is just a really crucial part of Bro moving forward as a large open source project, stable, and as a vector for support. You know, NSF at some point is going to probably decide, well, we can't invest further in this. We've put a lot in it, gotten a lot out of it, but you know, we're the National Science Foundation. And the Bro project needs to develop ways of sustaining support. And as you can see, it's not cheap. All right? We're spending $1 million a year to develop the project and bring it to the point it's at. Okay, with that, 3 minutes left. Happily take questions or comments.
Becoming much more interactive with software-defined networking and reactive.
SDN. Yeah, okay, good point. Yeah. That's one I just personally don't have on my radar because I don't interact with that part of it. Yeah. But I showed the 100 gig story earlier, right? Yeah.
Can you talk for a minute about Broala, Bro Foundation, the interplay, and what?
So Broala is the company that Seth, Robin, and I founded, and Greg is one of our key advisors, and Adam is another. And its role is to provide industrial-grade bro support in various ways. as the banner out there says, there'll be an announcement, you know, this evening about one direction of that. It is crucial to us to maintain the full vibrancy of the open source project. Right? So I put up SourceFire earlier, and as we watched that unfold, our read was a lot of unhappy open source Snort users over the model. Now, the model there is somewhat different, right? So with SourceFire, part of the key analysis juice in due to how Snort is structured is signatures. And if you're going to develop signatures privately, then you can make them a commercial thing that the open source community does not benefit from immediately. The Notion umbrella is not that. It's not about developing, you know, key scripts that detect various things. It's about you want to run Bro at your site as effectively as you can, and in a way where you know that there is industrial grade support for it, you come to a company.
Just hang up on you and things like that.
If you run it for several days, it just hangs up on you?
Yeah.
Well, it shouldn't, you know. And so the, you know, so am I right, Ashish, that, you know, the ongoing bros just run at LBL? Yeah. They just run. So I mean, that took a long time to get there because that, and I mentioned earlier about state management, which is one big headache for that. But the goal is that it is essentially achieves a steady state in terms of state consumption, and then that's it. So you know, there you can write scripts that leak, in which case you will use up all your memory. That's the main reason why Bro wouldn't just keep running. Indeed, in the old days, no way, it would just die. And I showed you the plot. But that shouldn't happen today.
Where did the name come from?
Can't see you. Where did the name come from? Yeah, thanks for reminding me of that. I meant to mention that. If when you look in the Bro paper, it has a little footnote about it. The name is direct reference to Big Brother. And it has always bothered me, and it should, I think, bother me, that this technology is terrific Snoop technology. You know, it's dual use. And I didn't ever want to forget that fact, that there's great utility in being able to analyze all this traffic. And I wish we didn't need it. I wish people would behave, but they don't. But it still bothers me how incredibly enabling it is for snooping. So that's why it's named Bro. Anything else? All right, thank you.